Well, good morning, gang. Welcome to Real Life here at Lakewood, here in the Worship Center. For those of us who are here in person, for those of you who are joining us online. Hey, guys, guess what? School starts. Are we ready? Yeah! Come on. Teachers are going back. School starts this week or next week or sometime. But we're glad you're here. Has the summer flown by or what? Man, it's crazy, but a lot going on here at Lakewood. God has been very good to us in the ministry, and you'll hear a lot of that this afternoon that Dr. Tyler is going to be sharing more about. A couple of things I want to tell you real quick before we enter into our time of praise and worship. If you've not picked up your August Connect, need to do so. You can see pictures of our Connect there. Our August Connect, for those who might be new with us, Connect is just our way of letting you know all that's going on here at Lakewood. And obviously we can't put it all in one published form, but you have QR codes that you can scan with your phone, your device, and it can send you to a digital format that lets you know everything. So if you are new here to Lakewood and you want to know more about the ministries, whether it's children, music, worship, students, adults, men's, women's, any of that kind of stuff. If you want to know, just get your Connect and scan the QR codes in there. This afternoon, or this evening at 6:30 over at Francis Meadows, we're going to have our annual pool baptism. And this is going to be a celebration. We've got a host of kids that will be baptized that have made decisions throughout the past several months. And I encourage you to be there. The beauty of this is at Francis Meadows over near Gainesville Middle School, we'll have a time of baptism. And then afterwards, they open up the whole pool for children. So if you want to bring your children there and let them have some last minute summer fun, love for you to bring them there. That's 6:30 tonight at Francis Meadows as we celebrate believers baptism with a lot of our children. There'll be a parent connection lunch for parents of middle school and high school students next Sunday. So if you have children in middle school or high school, and Jamie and his team with the Next Generation team want to take you through just what to expect there. So love for you to be a part of that. You can learn more by going to the student ministry page. You can register online as well. First Wednesday night, back for kids and students, will be August the 10th. I think that's 2 weeks from this. No, that's 1 week. 1 week from this Wednesday. So that's for our children. Kindergarten through students, that starts back on August the 10th. There'll be a parent connection as well that night. So parents, if you want to be a part of connecting, this is separate from the middle school and high school connection. This is for kindergarten through fifth graders. If you have kids that are in that, there'll be a parent connect that night as well. All of this is in your Connect. Is in your Connect magazine. So if you want to know more about this, if I stumbled and fumbled and bumbled through it and you have no clue what I just said, just go to lakewoodlife.org/events and you'll catch all of the details there. I know we have a lot of guests with us this morning. I've seen new faces as I've walked into the facilities here. And so on behalf of Dr. Tyler and the rest of the staff here at Lakewood, I want to thank you for being here. We know in our life and in our times, we can choose a lot of places. We have a lot of options of things to do, but you've chosen to be here. And we believe God's going to honor you in that. We're going to do our best to provide an experience where you can encounter the living God. Stand with me. Psalm 95, verses 1 through 3 says this. Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God, and a great king above all gods. Father, you're good. You're great. You're awesome. You're worthy of praise. Receive the songs and praise of our lips. We pray now in Jesus' name. Amen.
Yeah. Lord Jesus, we know that you're here. We thank you so much for being the head and the king of the church, but having so much love for us, knowing us personally and allowing us to pray to you. Thank you, Jesus, for allowing us to do this life together. We pray in Jesus' name. As a church, one of the most special times of every single Sunday morning is when we gather and we sing and we pray, because it should remind us that this is the gospel that we're rehearsing every week, to call ourselves back to repent and to follow after our King. It should also remind us every week, for we need reminded, I need reminded, that we do not do life alone. So as we pray together this morning, let's lift our voices up as one church to our King, our Savior, our Redeemer, but also our Sustainer and our Friend. Amen? Our Comforter. Let's lift our voices as one church to our God. Will you pray the address prayer with me this morning, as well as the confession of worship, so that we're reminded why we are here? Let's pray. Father God, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, God of Israel, God and Father of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, true and living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, have mercy and hear our prayer. Yes, Lord Jesus, we pray to you. Let's pray this confession of worship together. We have gathered in the name of Jesus Christ. We have come to this time to worship God. We have come to confess that Jesus is Lord. We are not here to be entertained. We are here to encounter Jesus. We are not consumers. We are worshipers. We praise and adore the living God, who is Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Let's continue to sing.
I just wanna speak the name. from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name, Jesus. Oh, shout Jesus from the mountains, Jesus in the streets, and Jesus in the darkness over every enemy. Jesus, for my family, I speak the holy name of Jesus.
You may be seated. It's great to be with you today. As always, I mean, today's no exception. I genuinely enjoy being in your presence, and I hope you do too. I'm sure you do, right? How could you not enjoy being with me? And I'm just, okay. We've gone off the rails. Let me start over. Good morning. I'm glad you're here. Man, it's good to be with you. Look, we've got so many good things worth talking about and celebrating, but we're going to hold off to the annual business conference, which is right after this service. Now, what you're going to find when you come to the annual business conference right after this service is you'll be given a booklet. And in that booklet, which is about 60 pages long, which is like a book, you're going to find stories and reports from all of our various ministries over this last year of ministry work. August 1, tomorrow, August 1st, begins our new church year. So as a church, our church year goes from August 1 to July 31, which means tomorrow, August 1st, is our first day of our new church year. And so what we do every year at our annual business conference is report on what the Lord did among us this last year and prepare ourselves for what He has in store for us next year. So at our conference today, right after this service, in this room, you'll get this booklet, and it's going to be filled. It's going to be filled with all sorts of ministry reports that we've seen the Lord do through our ministry by His grace and because of your faithfulness to be a part of what He's doing here. It's pages of it. And I'm sure when you come and look through it, you'll find some stuff that you were very familiar with, and you'll probably find some stuff that you had no idea that we got to be a part of as a church. And your participation in this church means you get to celebrate that as our work together. So this is always an important time in the life of our church, because we're going to be reminded that the Lord has been active throughout our ministry in ways that we could never have imagined before. But we also need to make sure we do this, that we don't allow our celebrations to lead to any complacency. There is work to be done. The work that the Lord has done through this ministry over the years, and especially over this last year, is preparing us for where he's taking us into the future. I've never been more excited about the future of our ministry than I am right now. The Lord is preparing us for new and significant and meaningful ministries that we have never engaged in the life of our church before. And if we're going to join him in where he's leading us, then we have to come together and catch this vision. So that today, what we'll do is spend most of our time celebrating what the Lord has done, reminding ourselves of what he's done, and then we're going to use that as a springboard to prepare our church and ourselves for where he's taking us into the future. So don't miss the opportunity to be part of this special day, Business Comments, right after this. Get your booklets. We'll go through it. You'll see everything the Lord did this last year in our ministry, and it'll prepare us for where he's taking us next. He's been so good and so gracious to us. Look, if this is the first time you've ever been with us in our church, I hope that today you'll begin to experience the goodness of God shown towards us, that he allows us to be a part of his work through this congregation. It amazes me, and I hope you'll come today, and I think you'll be amazed too. So it'll be a wonderful celebration. Come, you'll get the booklets, and then you can take those home, study, pray through them, thank God for them, and prepare for what he has next for us, because it's significant, and it's meaningful, and it's worth doing. So let's do it, church. All right, in light of all of this that's coming up, Psalm 111 is a psalm that's filled with giving God thanks for what he's done. And so I thought today, why don't we spend our prayer time as a church this morning in Psalm 111 and let this be our guide, because it's filled with praising God for what he's done here. So won't you join me in prayer? You can follow along Psalm 111 if you want. We're just going to pray through it, but you don't have to. Let's just go to the Lord in prayer. Won't you join me? Oh God, we praise you, our Lord. We give thanks to the Lord our God with our whole hearts. In the company of the upright, in the company of this congregation, we give you praise. Great are your works, O Lord. Your works are studied by all who delight in them. O God, help us today to study the many works that you've done among us. Cause us to delight in them. Your works are full of splendor and majesty. Your works are righteous and they endure forever. You cause wondrous works to be remembered. For you, O Lord, are gracious and merciful. You provide food to those who fear you. You remember your covenant forever. You've shown your people the power of your works. You've given us an inheritance. The works of your hand, O God, are faithful and just. Your precepts are trustworthy. They're established forever and ever to be performed with faithfulness and with uprightness. You have sent redemption for your people. You've commanded your covenant promises forever. Holy and awesome is your name. And so now we will fear the Lord. For the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Help us, O Lord, to be wise. All those who practice your wisdom have good understanding. May your praise, O God, endure forever. We thank you, Lord, for your mighty work among us. Help us to celebrate what you have done among our church for your kingdom's sake. And we pledge that in the midst of our celebration, we will give you the glory. We will give your name the praise for everything you have done. We will not take the credit for your work. We will not rob you of your glory, but we will recognize and acknowledge that every good thing that we have been a part of has come through your power, by your grace, accomplished through the work of your Son for our benefit. And in the midst of our celebrating, God, will you give us a vision? Ignite our souls for the vision you have for this church, that we would be launched out into this new ministry year with vigor, with excitement, and full of passion for your ministry. As we reflect now on the giving of our time, our talent, and our treasure, we ask that you would take all that's given to you and use it for your kingdom's sake, and use us for your ministry. Now prepare our hearts to hear your word, that we may be changed through what we hear. And we pray this in Christ's name. God's people said, amen.
Jesus said that if I thirst,
Let's start with a little exercise, shall we? Not the physical kind, just the mental kind. If I named a person, could you, in one sentence, describe the most significant part of that person's life? You think you could do that? Not that you have to say it out loud. I mean, some of you I know, regardless of what I say, will shout out loud. Some of you I know, regardless of what I offered, you would never say anything out loud in here. You don't have to. Let's just try. Whisper it to the person next to you and you can show them how smart you are. What if I named a person? Could you say in one sentence what best describes that person's life? Christopher Columbus. Alexander the Great. Martin Luther King Jr. Babe Ruth. Nelson Mandela. What about Abraham Lincoln? Charles Spurgeon? Anyone? If your answer is anything other than the greatest preacher ever in the English language, your answer, friend, is wrong. All right, what about books? You think you could do it for a book? One sentence, describe the most significant part of the book, what the book is all about. Christmas Carol by Charles Dickens. What about Don Quixote by Miguel de Cervantes? In fact, something even better than describing Don Quixote in one sentence, if you can spell Quixote, that's an accomplishment. Okay, that's a really hard one to spell. What about The Lord of the Rings by J.R.R. Tolkien? Could you describe this in one sentence? An epic quest of how good ultimately conquers evil? That would be the right answer. Pilgrim's Progress? What about Moby Dick? I mean, it's about fishing, right? I've never actually read that one. It's very long. Pretty sure it's about fishing. If you've never read a book and you like fishing, maybe this is your entry point. There seems to be lots of material. All right, let's press this point home. There's a book in the Bible named after the author. It's in the Old Testament. The author was a prophet whose name was Joel. And that's what this book in the Old Testament is called, Joel. And if you had to describe in one sentence what the book of Joel is all about, probably the answer that you would give would come something like this. The book of Joel is about the day of the Lord. That's what it's about. The book of Joel is about the day of the Lord. That is the day when the Lord will judge in righteousness all the earth and will redeem and rescue, drawing into himself forever his own people. The day of the Lord. That's what the book of Joel is all about. Now, to us, this book, and if you've read along with us as our church, we're reading through these minor prophets, remember, and you can follow along and read along with us through them. And if you have been doing that, if you've ever read Joel, you've probably recognized that it sounds a little bit odd to us, maybe even uncomfortable at times as he talks about the day of the Lord. But apparently, as we'll see this morning, hopefully, it was anything but odd or uncomfortable to the first disciples of Jesus Christ. You see, this book of Joel to us probably has a sense of being strange or difficult to explain. But did you know that the book of Joel was the first thing on the Apostle Peter's mind when he stood up to preach his first open sermon after Jesus had ascended? I mean, just think about that for a moment. The book that to us may seem so odd and strange and difficult to explain is the first thing that came to the Apostle Peter's mind when he stood up to preach the first open sermon after Jesus had ascended, the book of Joel. Now, I'm just saying that if you're trying to distance yourself from a book that seems odd or hard to explain, you probably don't want the first thing you do to be a reference to the book of Joel. And yet that's exactly what they did. You see, to us, Joel seems hard to explain, but to the first Christians, it explained to those around them what they couldn't otherwise understand about Jesus. So why don't we read a little bit of it today? You can follow along in your outlines. I printed some of the text, but let's put together, and I'm going to read the sections of Joel from chapters 1 and 2 to help us get an understanding of what Joel, the prophet, and his book is all about. It starts like this, Joel chapter 1, verse 1. The word of the Lord came to Joel, the son of Pethuel. Hear this, you elders, give ear, all inhabitants of the lands. Has such a thing happened in your days or in the days of your fathers? Tell your children of it and let your children tell their children and their children to another generation. Joel 1, verse 15. Alas, for the day of the Lord is near, and as destruction from the Almighty, it comes. Chapter 2, verse 1. Blow a trumpet in Zion, sound the alarm on my holy mountain. Let all the inhabitants of the land tremble, for the day of the Lord is coming. It is near, a day of darkness and gloom, a day of clouds and thick darkness. Thick blackness there is spread upon the mountains, a great and powerful people. Their like has never been known before, nor will it be again after them through the years of all their generations. Chapter 2, verse 12. Yet even now, declares the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, with mourning, and rend your hearts, not your garments. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and he relents over disaster. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Verse 15, blow a trumpet in Zion, consecrate a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people, consecrate the congregation, assemble the elders, gather the children, even the nursing infants. Let the bridegroom leave his room, and let the bride leave her chamber. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priest, the ministers of the Lord, weep and say, spare your people, O Lord, and make not your heritage a reproach. Make not your heritage a byword among the nations. Why should they say to the peoples among us, where is their God? Then the Lord became jealous for his land and had pity on his people. Verse 25, the Lord said, I will restore you to your years that the swarming, wow, that was loud. Why don't we start verse 25 for that? That's still loud. Testing. That's off. No, is that on? Oh, that. Do that again. Was that me? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. Don't move. We're in verse 25. The day of the Lord. You got it right. In the midst of the day of the Lord. Don't move. The Lord says, verse 25, I will restore to you the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, the cutter, my great army which I sent among you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied, and you shall praise the name of the Lord your God, who's dwelt wondrously with you. And my people, says the Lord, shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I am the Lord your God, and there is none else. And my people shall never again be put to shame. Verse 28, it shall come to pass afterward, says the Lord. I will pour out my spirit on all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your own old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. Even on the male and female servants in those days, I will pour out my spirit and I will show wonders in the heavens and wonders on the earth, blood and fire and columns of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood before the great and awesome day of the Lord comes. And it shall come to pass that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This is God's word. Look, in the first two chapters, it's laid out very clearly that the book of the prophet of Joel is all about the coming day of the Lord. The key theme of the the book of Joel is about the day of the Lord, God coming of in righteousness, judging all nations of the earth and restoring to himself his own people. And the key mark of this day, we read it right at the end, verses 28 and following, the key mark of that day coming is the descending of God's Spirit. It's the coming down of God's Spirit. Now, this is exactly what the apostles saw happening to them in their own time. This is why in Acts 2, what the apostles of Jesus saw occurring in their minds, they went straight to Joel. You see, because the key mark of this day is when the Lord's Spirit comes down on his people. So in Acts chapter 2, we read that it was the day of Pentecost. And this is what we're doing as we're reading the minor prophets. We're seeing how the New Testament authors were shaped by their prophecy, were shaped by their letters, but also how they even quoted their letters. And that's exactly what happens in Acts chapter 2, that it was the day of Pentecost and all the apostles were together in one place. And it says, suddenly there came from heaven the sound like a mighty rushing wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. And there were divided tongues that looked like fire that were appearing over each one's head, and it rested on each one of them. And they were filled with the Holy Spirit, and they began speaking in tongues as the Spirit gave utterance. And it says that in that time there were in Jerusalem many people from many different languages, from many different nations, devout men from every nation under heaven, it says. And when the multitude was speaking regarding the story of the person and work of Jesus Christ, each one in attendance in their own languages was hearing this message in their own tongue. I mean, it was the miracle of all miracles. That as they spoke multiple languages at the same time in their own languages without translation could understand and hear their message. And when the apostles saw this, they thought immediately of Joel. In fact, Peter stood up and he says, what you've seen here is not a group of men, as you suppose, who are drunk. It's only the third hour. But in Acts 2:16, Peter says, what has been uttered from the prophet Joel is what you are witnessing now. The last days it shall be, God declares, that I'll pour out my Spirit on all flesh. Your sons and daughters shall prophesy. Your young men shall see visions. Your old men shall dream dreams, even on male and female servants. In those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. And I will show wonders in the heavens and signs on the earth below, blood and fire and vapor of smoke. The sun shall be turned to darkness, the moon to blood, before that day of the Lord comes, that great and magnificent day. And it shall come to pass, Peter says, quoting Joel, that everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved. So what you see happening is the day of the Lord promised and talked about in the book of Joel is marked by the coming of the Spirit and occurs in the first two chapters of Acts. That is still loud. Should I switch? Should I use this one? Yes. Is there a second? Getting ready for our business meeting. Turn this off. Check. There we go. Okay, I'm going to use this. That will not happen again. What you see happening in Acts is exactly what Joel prophesied in Joel chapter 2. Now, there's incredible depth to what we see happening with the Spirit coming down and the Spirit empowering God's people to be and do who they were meant to be. But if you want to be a part of what it means to be filled with the Spirit, and if you want to be prepared as Joel speaks of the coming day of the Lord, you must be filled with the Spirit. And it will look at least like these three ways: true repentance, a deepening of your hope, and a clarity in your words. When the Spirit comes down and prepares us for the coming, it's already occurred, right? So this has started, broken into our world, the coming day of the Lord. The Spirit has come. If you experience the Spirit in the way that he comes, it will show at least these three ways: true repentance, deep hope, and clarity of your words. The first work of the Spirit is this, that the Spirit in the life of the Christian leads the Christian in true repentance. Now, this is the promise that Joel made, that when people finally turn from their ways and turn back to God, when they repent and go to the Lord, that he will show grace on them and receive them to himself. And this is also what Peter has to say, that this message, the coming of the Spirit, does. That's why at the end of Peter's sermon, after the Spirit has descended, and those who are listening said, what should we do? The first thing that Peter said, do you remember this? In Acts 2:38, what shall we do? And Peter said, repent. Repent. The first thing that the Spirit does in the life of a Christian is draws you into repentance. And it makes sense that the Spirit had to come and do this first, because unless the Spirit comes, you will not be drawn into the repentance that you've been called to. You will not turn from your sin, and you will not turn to God. That's why the 17th century British English Puritan Thomas Brooks said, to repent of sin is as great a work of grace as not to sin itself. See what he's saying? That repenting of our sin is such a work of grace, it requires as much grace as to refuse sin in the first place. That repenting and turning to God requires God's grace and God's Spirit to come into you. That's why Thomas Brooks went on to say that true repentance is a gift from above. And if the Lord doesn't give it, then we will perish for lack of it. You see, it's worth noting that at the sight of the Spirit coming in power, the first thing that is called for is repentance. So what does repentance look like? What does it mean to turn from your ways and turn to the Lord instead? It means at least this. First, a deeper knowledge of God. Knowing the Lord in a deeper and more intimate way. In Joel's time, he was taken up by the task of showing what God was really like. And the same thing in Peter's sermon in Acts 2. He wanted to show who Jesus really is and what God is really like. That's why it all comes to a head, really, in Joel 2:13. When Joel, speaking of the day of the Lord, the coming of the Spirit, and who this God is, says, return to the Lord. Why? Because he's gracious and merciful, slow to anger, abounding in steadfast love, and relents over disaster. Your call to return to the Lord is based on your deepening of the knowledge of who God is. So when he says, come to the Lord, he doesn't say because it'll make you feel better. He says, come to the Lord because of who he is. You have to know him more deeply, not less intimately, more intimately. And you'll be drawn into a greater awareness of who he is and what he's doing. Repentance means you go deeper into your knowledge of God. And it means that in your heart, you experience change. Nothing short of that. It has to go to your heart. You see, the Lord is after your heart. I mean, just listen to how Joel describes repentance in his book, in Joel 2:12. Return even now, declares the Lord. Return to me with all your heart, with weeping, with fasting, with mourning. Rend your hearts, not your garments. The Lord is not after merely the sacrifices that we make in our lives, the giving of our things back to him in honor of him. The Lord is interested in our hearts. When you come to the Lord, this is how you come. This is what repentance of the heart looks like. It looks like, frankly, what Joel says in chapter 1, verse 5. Wake up. Maybe I should pop the microphone again. Wake up. Right? That's what repentance looks like. It causes you to be awakened to the realities of who God is and what he's calling you to. Now, I'm afraid that too often for many of us as Christians, we've been lulled to sleep in this world. The world is constantly lulling us to sleep, to forget the things of God and to turn our attention to something else, which means to take our focus off of the Lord. And all along, Joel, Paul in Ephesians is calling us, wake up. And this is a common thing. I mean, look, have you ever heard of the woke movement? You heard woke, right? You know where that, the language, I'm not going to talk about what it is, and we're not getting into that. But just to recognize, I mean, it sounds cool and modern when you take a word and you make up an incorrect verb tense and then use it and apply it as an ideology for life. But it's biblical language. Wake up. That's what the message of the Bible is constantly saying. Awaken, that's the appropriate verb tense. Awaken, come to life. It's a call to wake up. That's what repentance of your heart is. Now, let me just pause for a moment and speak directly to the men in here. Men and young men. not at the exclusion of women. In fact, come back next week, we'll switch roles, okay? We'll, men and young men. This is something that we need to hear. Because have you ever noticed, men, in your own hearts, that there is a longing to do something that really matters? I mean, there is a desire in you to do something that's worthwhile, that's significant, that's meaningful, that matters, and that's greater and larger than yourself, and you want to be a part of that. It's in our hearts. And I've noticed that in the lives of many men and young men that I've been around in my life, that there's this strong desire to do something that's worthwhile. And I've seen many men who've struggled with this because they feel that their life and the things that they've dedicated themselves to are anything but worthwhile. And it oftentimes leads to anger or depression. Oftentimes it shows itself as addictions, or it comes out as pure apathy because, frankly, they've given up on trying to do anything anymore. Men and young men, what the Bible is saying to you is wake up. There is for you a significant calling in the Lord that will outweigh anything you think that this world can provide for you by way of significance. The Lord is calling you to be the man that he means for you to be. And when you become the man that you are meant to be in him, you will find the significance that you have been longing for all your life. It can never come through the things of this world. It will only come when you begin to live into what it means to be who you were created to be. The culture around us is confused on manhood. It's unclear and uncertain about what it means to be a man. But the Bible is not. It calls men to stand up, be strong, stand for the truth, do what the Lord has called us to do, lead, serve, be wise, teach, grow your family, and be who you were meant to be. And in these things, you will find significance unlike anything else you can ever experience in this life. It will not come from your jobs. It will not come from your hobbies. It will not come from your works. It will only come, the significance that you're longing for, when you wake up to what the Lord is doing. And you must repent from the things that are drawing you down if you're to experience that. The Lord is clear. He's calling you. Come to him. That's the first work of the Lord. He means for you to turn and come. And when you do, when you sense the Spirit of the living God alive in you in this way, it will deepen your hope. It will draw you deeper down into a hope that's greater than anything the world has to offer. And it's a grim message that Joel has to say, the day of the Lord. It's about darkness. It's about fire. I mean, in one illustration, he says in Joel 2:3 that it's like the land looks like the Garden of Eden before and afterwards it looks like a desolate wilderness, utter and complete destruction. That's what the day of the Lord looks like as he describes it. And yet in the very next verses, in verses 21 and 23, Joel says the same thing. Be glad, rejoice. Be glad and rejoice. Now, how can he possibly say that in the midst of destruction and violence and darkness and utter gloom? Be glad, rejoice. Twice he says it. It's hope. That's what he's saying. That if you've been filled with the Spirit of God, you will experience a hope that goes deeper and further than anything else you could have ever known. And the world is looking for this. The world is looking for this kind of hope. I mean, can I just look? I exercise from time to time, and I love to listen to podcasts and lectures and audiobooks and all this, but I was in a little bit of a lull, so I did something novel. I listened to music when I exercised. It's the first time I've ever done it. You ever tried it? And I listened to music, and you'd be amazed at what will pop up if you open the app and just type exercise music. All kinds of things come up. I mean, I'm embarrassed to say a little bit. I just fast forward a lot. But there's this one song. Look, you know, music mostly works like when you're exercising. It gets you going. It gets your vibes. And you just, you know, you feel good. And you just keep going, right? That's how it's supposed to work. For me, though, it was the lyrics. Like, I listened to what they said. And in my oddity, it just distracted me. And that's how I made it through my exercise. I was fascinated with the lyrics that they said. So this is not an endorsement, and I'm not going to say too much about it, but there's one that popped up, a singer by the name of Florence Welch, a popular song about a decade ago, and here's the refrain that plays throughout. So I'll put my faith in something unknown, but I'm tired of hope with nothing to hold. Of course, that was right before the ooh-ah, sweet nothing, ooh-ah, 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 nothing, ooh-ah. But right before that, the refrain, I put my faith in something unknown, but I'm tired of hope with nothing to hold. And as I'm exercising, I think, is she really thinking that? I mean, that is a profound realization that she has in her mind recognized she has a hope for something. And she can't grasp it. And she's even made a connection between faith in something and hope, ultimately, in life. That she knows wherever she's putting her faith in that thing, she's looking for hope, and she can't find it. And I think to myself, if we're honest with ourselves, that's all of us. We're looking for hope. And outside of what the Lord offers, we can't find it because the day of the Lord is coming. And if we're putting our hope in anything other than the Lord Himself, all we will experience is utter destruction. Joel is as clear as he can be. C.S. Lewis very famously said it like this: most people, if they had really learned to look into their own hearts, would know that they do want, and they want acutely, something that they cannot have in this world. But he says, if I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world. That's the hope that is held out to the Christian. A hope that no matter how bad things get, you can have a certainty of life. Why? Why can you have hope regardless of the circumstances? Because the Christian hope is based on the character of God. It's based on His grace. Joel 2:18, that the Lord looked and had pity on His people. The Christian can hope in grace. It's also based on the Lord's goodness, that He wants you to be satisfied, and He wants to give you every good thing in life. And it's based on the Lord's glory. The glory of God Himself is why He satisfies His people. He says in verse 26, you shall eat plenty and be satisfied. Why? Verse 2:27. Because I am the Lord your God, and there is none else. The reason that you can have hope is because by God's character, He is a God of grace. He means to overwhelm you with His goodness, and it's dependent on His own glory, and He will not forsake His glory. That you know as a Christian, you can hope in Him because it's based on who He is. This is what the Spirit does in you. It calls you to turn away from the things of this world, turn to the Lord, put your hope in Him, and then He'll clarify your words. Because He's sending you out. By His Spirit, He's now going to send you out with this hope in your hearts. Having turned and come and instilled a deepening hope in your life, He's going to send you out. Because this gospel, He says, number one, is for all people. Which is the ultimate surprise of the gospel, that it's not for any one type of person or any one language or any one group of people or any one nation. It's for all people, that the gospel is meant to be heard and proclaimed to all. And the message of the gospel centers around Jesus Christ Himself. That's why the Spirit, when He comes down, He clarifies for the apostles precisely who Jesus is. I mean, that Peter's first sermon in Acts, filled with the Holy Spirit, is all about who Jesus is and what He did. That's the whole sermon. This Jesus whom you crucified, God has raised from the dead, and He has seated Him at the right hand of the Father in glory. That's what their message is. Nothing else. It's all founded on who Jesus is. And when the Spirit invades your life like this, He will clarify your words so that everything you speak of the hope that you have, regardless of your situations on earth, will always point to who Jesus is and what He did. And now, friend, He's sending you out. You'll know you're filled with the Spirit when He sends you out. Because the gospel must go out. The gospel must go out because the message is that anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. That means that every tribe, tongue, and nation must hear this gospel. Because it's for anyone. Joel says it. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Peter says it, quoting Joel. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Paul says in Romans 10, anyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. This gospel now must go out and be proclaimed among all the nations. That's what it looks like to be filled with God's Spirit. The coming day of the Lord is imminent. It's not far off, as many are wont to think. The day of the Lord will come. It will be a day when the Lord judges with righteousness and when he calls to himself all who are his. The mark of the coming of the day is the Spirit of God empowering his people, and he's come. And if you will so come to the Lord, he will fill you. He'll turn you back to him. He'll fill your heart up with hope and every good thing, and he'll send you out into the world that is desperately waiting on this message. That's Joel. Maybe we need to fill up our hearts a little more with the message of Joel. Let me pray for us. Lord, would you in our hearts cause us to be a people who long to be filled with your Spirit? And having been filled, constantly turn to you in repentance, find your mercy and love, and are sent out with the hope of the gospel to all the nations. Make this our vision, O Lord our God. For the sake of your name, we pray. God's people said, amen. Would you stand with me, and we'll close our time with one final song. And this is an opportunity for us to respond where you stand or sit to what the Lord has said, to respond in prayer, in singing, to come to this altar and pray perhaps at what the Lord has shown you in your own heart, where men would actually pray behind you. They'll intercede on your behalf. You could do that at this altar. Or you can ask one of our prayer counselors who could pray for you. But whatever you do, let's respond to this word from the Lord. God bless you.
Peace, bring it all to peace. The storm surrounding me, let it break. At your name still, call the sea to still. The rage in me to still, every wave. At your name, Jesus, Jesus. You make the darkness tremble, Jesus, Jesus, you silence fear. Jesus, Jesus, you make the darkness tremble. Jesus, Jesus, breathe. Call these bones to live. Call these lungs to sing once again. shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome.
Let's proclaim.
Your name is life, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is life that the shadows can't deny. Your name cannot be overcome. Your name is life, forever lifted high. Your name cannot be overcome. Jesus, Jesus.
Amen. Okay, let's do one thing real quick. Just stand where you are. I want to invite a special friend. Her name's Aniston Bangs, and Mom and Dad, Andy and Mandy, y'all come too. And this is Steve McNeely, and y'all come, everybody. Just come, everybody. This is Steve McNeely. He's one of our deacon ministers, and this is Aniston, and she comes today to make public her faith in Jesus Christ, and amen. Praise the Lord for that. And we've already been speaking with Aniston. She's been talking with her parents too, and she'll be participating in tonight's baptism, which we're very excited about that. And we're so thrilled, Aniston, to see the Lord's work in your life. And we're excited to celebrate with you this morning. So let's celebrate with Aniston one more time. Praise the Lord for her. Amen. And come to our baptism tonight. It'll be a wonderful time. And why don't y'all stand here with Steve, our deacon minister, and there may be some special friends who want to come and say hello. God bless you. We're so excited about this, and we look forward to celebrating at pool baptism tonight. Hope you'll come to that. Business conference right after this, so if there's anything that's caused you to leave quickly, maybe that will do it. But no, we'll turn the room. Don't leave. It's so good. And then business conference, we'll have it right after this. Why don't we close our time with a benediction from God's Word. Pastor Zach, I'll be in the back. Love to say hello to you, especially if you're our guest. Won't you stop by?
Amen. Today's benediction is from Galatians chapter 3. Let's let these words from Scripture be what sends us from this place to be God's hands and feet. Will you say this with me? May we remember that there is neither Jew nor Greek. There is neither slave nor free. There is no male and female, for we are all one in Christ Jesus. And if we are Christ's, then we are Abraham's offspring, heirs according to the promise. Amen? Amen. Amen. You may go in peace.